Okay, let's get started. Did y'all get through it? It's kind of hard. Very, very original. I'll tell you a little bit about it. So I think we have similar churches. I might be a little bit in the middle, which you don't have. You have the beginning and the end. Okay. So before we start, right, just a few words what he's trying to do, right? Obviously, this is philosophy of science, right? Not science. And he's basing himself on the science of the time, which is evolutionary biology. And what's interesting is that you have to know a little bit what he's trying to do. What is his agenda here in this book to really understand what he's doing? So he's a priest, right? And he's a Catholic priest. Catholics don't believe in evolution, right? Catholicism believes in creation. God creates human being, right? God creates the whole world in 7 days, places the human being in a garden, and then takes it from there. So when Darwin started his theory and when evolutionary theory became fact, became science, right? Catholics were like, okay, now what do? Now we sound like morons, basically. So this has been a practice of Catholicism throughout the ages. Each time there is science, right, that really stands its ground, that makes sense, they try to really make bridges, right, between their faith and science. So it's interesting. Catholicism is like that very, it's actually very open in that sense, right? So throughout the ages, the priests, right, of Catholic priests have tried to see where are the connections between what we believe and science, and can we synthesize the two, right? And they did this not only with science, but with folk traditions. This is also an interesting feature of Catholicism, unlike Islam or Judaism or, you know, evangelical Christianity. When they go somewhere and there's already a religion, they're going to try to merge with it, right? So they're going to blend. They're going to borrow elements from that religion, integrate it in their faith so that you can have a kind of, so people don't have to reject their native beliefs and they can still be Christian and something else, right? So you see this, especially if you come from Latin America, you're aware that Catholicism is full of stuff that comes from native traditions, actually. If the Catholicism of, for example, Latin America. So this is very typical. So here in this book, he's really trying to bridge Catholicism, his faith, his Christian faith, with the data of evolutionary theory. And he's doing a magnificent job out of, you know, entering the process, right? Really, he's really kind of aligning himself with the evolutionary biology and drawing from it this amazing Christian message of love and community and kingdom and so forth. So it's quite brilliant, right? I wish people would read him more because I find him really, really exquisite as a thinker. So now you know what he's trying to do. So let's go into the details. The reason, of course, why we're doing this mostly is to understand Senghor, because Senghor is going to build his whole philosophy on him. He's going to base everything that he says, or Senghor is going to connect some of the African traditional thought with what he believes is the contemporary scientific and philosophical thought of the West, and he's using Teilhard, Chardin as a bridge, right? So to understand Senghor deeply, we have to understand this deeply because Senghor is constantly referring back to Teilhard, Chardin because that's his basis. That's his scientific basis for what he's affirming in a lot of his philosophy. Okay, two main points I'm gonna make. Number one, from simplicity to complexity. So you can write this down, from simplicity to complexity. So I mentioned passing last time. And then number two, from matter to consciousness. That's the outline for today. From matter to consciousness. Okay, so tell me please which pages you have. I just need to know. What did I give you? 237? Two? I didn't give you earlier pages, earlier chapters. No? Okay, that's fine. We'll learn them together. And then when I get to, so I'll be skipping around in the book and I'll just quote and you can, maybe I'll quote a few things you can write down, but you can just get the main idea of as I'm reading. So, okay. So first, the first point he's going to make. So he's looking at evolutionary biology, right? Which is, for those of you who don't know, this is the idea that we have evolved from very simple organisms. So basically it goes like this. There was the Big Bang. And then there was the first tiny organism, kind of, they're trying to replicate this right now in Switzerland. They're trying to have all the conditions of the Big Bang and see if some kind of molecule, like a living being, can come out of it. And they're working on that. So it's theoretically possible that, boom, you have now a simple, very simple organism emerges from this cataclysm. And then evolutionary theory says that this organism evolves over millions and trillions of years as it's needing to evolve, right? So for example, it gets very cold, so it grows, fur or scales, right? So according to the needs, according to the environment, the organism will evolve and slowly, slowly evolves into more complex organisms. And then, so evolves to, I guess we learned this in school, right? It becomes first something in the water, and then it becomes kind of an amphibian, and then it becomes a reptile, and then it becomes, right, mammal, and it grows and grows and grows until you have evolves until you have a human being, right? So that's the idea. How they argue for this is they look at the fossils, right? They when you dig in the earth, you can see a progression between very if you go to the layers, right, of the earth. You can see very simple organisms getting more and more complex as the years evolve in time, right? So that's the main basis. The one problem with evolutionary theory, which still troubles me a bit, is there's no intermediary. We do not see how they go from species to species, right? You have a reptilian and then boom, you have mammals. So we don't see how the organisms are evolving into, we should have intermediate species, right? Half reptilian, half mammal, right? So we don't have those. We have just clear-cut layers, right? So it's still, in my view, it's still not yet a fully proved science, right? But it's pretty good. When you study it, it makes a lot of sense. So he's working with that. So he's going to go enter this theory, right? And he's going to show a number. He's going to interpret a number of these facts in a way that's really interesting for us. So from simplicity to complexity, right? So he says, first of all, two things are needed for an organism to grow from simple to complex. Two things are needed. You need an energy which attracts particles together, right? To have a complex organism which is made up of many particles, you need something which ties these particles together, right? The organism can only evolve if there is a force binding the different parts of that organism together. So as it's becoming more complex, there has to be a form keeping those, right? As it grows a little horn or a little fur or a paw, right? There has to be something keeping it together. It can't just be a paw and then it runs off, you know, right? Something must be keeping this organism together. And this he calls, you can write down, tangential energy, like tangent, T-A-N-G-E-N-T-I-A-L, right? Tangential energy. And I'll give you a quote on that. So on page 42, you can just listen. It's enough to just to know the material like this. So he says this, on page 42, he says, we do not get what we call matter as a result of the simple aggregation and juxtaposition of atoms, right? You don't get matter when there's just atoms together in a little bucket, right? He says, for that, a mysterious identity must absorb and cement them, an influence at which our mind rebels in bewilderment at first, but which in the end it must perforce accept. So he's saying there is, in all beings, there is a force keeping that being together. And we're going to see how he will call that force eventually, this attractive force, he calls it love, right? So you see how he's bridging with Christianity, right? But it's just an attractive force, right? If we didn't have this attractive force keeping us together, we would be constantly, arm would fall off, eye would go rolling over there, right? Eyelash would fly away, right? So there is something keeping us together, right? And this he calls, of course, love. So that's tangential energy. And then there's, so the reason I'm going into these details is that Senghor alludes to these concepts, right? So you need to know them a little bit. Then he continues and he says, there's also another energy. And here he's very close to Aristotle. He says there has to be also an energy drawing us from simplicity to complexity. right? We have to actually have something that moves us to become more complex. Otherwise, why should we? We're just sitting there in the water. We're happy, right? Why should we become more complex? So there's an energy pulling us towards more complexity. Does that make sense? Kind of. This energy he calls radial energy, R-A-D-I-A-L, radial energy. So there's two energies, one energy pulling us together, kind of going inside, going towards us, right? And then there's an energy pulling us towards further development, which is the radial energy. So here's a quote for that on page 42 also, actually 43. He says this, a more complete study of the movements of the world will oblige us little by little to turn it upside down. In other words, to discover, and this is the key, that if things hold and hold together, it is only by reason of complexity from above. So there's something pulling us towards complexity. Aristotle says something similar. If you studied Aristotle, when you study the four causes in Aristotle, one of them is the teleological cause, the cause based on the final product. So we are constantly pulled towards our final product. So the baby, when it's born, is moved towards its finished form as an adult. It's moving towards this kind of completed form. So that's kind of what he's saying here, very close to Aristotelian teleological cause. Okay. Okay, let me read you maybe one more quote on 107. I didn't want to give you the whole book, because maybe next time you'll buy the book, because I'm reading all over. But then I have to make you read the whole book, which is terrible. It's a really difficult book. Like, the main interesting parts were the beginning and the end, so the rest is all biology. Okay, let me skip that quote. Okay. Yeah. All right, so then he calls this energy, right, which binds us together and which is also moving us towards greater complexification, he calls this love, right? So that's where he's bridging with Christianity. Here's the quote for that. It's a beautiful quote on love on page 264. Okay. Do you have page 264? Yeah, you do. Go to page 264. Okay, you all have, let me see your text. On your computers. All right, good. All right, so here he says, when you see the section, love is energy, second paragraph. Considered, are you there? Who's there with me? One person, two. Considered in its full biological reality. Love, that is to say the affinity of being with being, is not peculiar to man. In other words, this love attraction, which we always say, oh, I love him, I love her, I'm attracted to this person, to that person. He says, this is not just human beings are experiencing this. All of reality is experiencing this force of attraction, right? And he says it is a general property of all life, and as such it embraces in its varieties and degrees all the forms successively adopted by organized matter. So he's saying at every moment of our evolution, love was there, drawing the particles together, holding us together, right? And bringing forth this ever more complex organisms and keeping them together. So that's the idea. He continues, same idea, driven by the forces of love. Hold on. Where is this ribbon business? I have another quote up to 64. I'm just going to continue reading. Go to... the middle of the last paragraph. I said earlier when we were discussing the within of things, do you see where I am? Wave at me if you're there. Yes, okay, good. So he said, continuing on the same idea, I said earlier when we were discussing the within of things, if there were no real internal propensity to unite, even at a prodigiously rudimentary level, indeed in the molecule itself, it would be physically impossible for love to appear higher up with us in homogenized form. So he's saying, this thing that, in other words, even at our most elementary particle, we're already trying to unite, right? This is a very strong, powerful force, which even the small molecule or the atom has, always trying to keep it together, right? To stay with, to bring together different factions, right? That's the atom, bringing together the proton, the neutron, the electron. keeping it together through this mysterious force which he calls up. So he said, even at the atomic level, love is at work. And as we get more and more complex, love is at work within us. And eventually, of course, he's going to talk about this big organism, right, where love will be a kind of, it will become a social organism, right? So, but it's very interesting how he sees love even at the micro particular level. And then as it's, as we evolve, still love and love and love and love is the principle of life, basically. That's what he's saying, which is very, very interesting. Of course, absolutely no scientific basis. There's not, we cannot see this on the microscope, right? But he's interpreting. He's saying, well, there must be something holding the stuff together, right? And he calls, and science, of course, doesn't go that far as to talk about that force. It should, why not, right? But he then goes and calls it love, right? Which it kind of makes sense, actually. Okay. So then he continues, right? Basically, we are born out of love and journeying towards love, right? Since we're born, we're being, every time we get more complex, it's more love, right? I'm a little molecule, I have several little atoms, right? Love. And then more molecules, more love, and so forth, right? He's saying that. Okay. Last quote. It's okay. All right. So that's the first part, right? Some of the technical terms, some of the ideas. Now let's go to the second part of what I want to talk about, which is from matter to consciousness. Okay. All right. So what he's noticing now is that, okay, we're getting more and more complex. But what he's noticing also at the same time as we're getting more and more complex in the evolutionary trajectory is we're getting more and more conscious. Okay, so that's an interesting observation he's making. As we get more complex, we become more conscious. So he's saying there is an evolution happening externally, and there is also an evolution happening internally, right? The external evolution is the material part where the molecules are getting more and more complex. That's the external evolution that you can see. But then at the same time, there's an internal evolution where we're becoming more and more conscious. Everybody with me? Right, so external evolution where we're materially becoming bigger organisms, more complex organisms. And internally, he's noticing there's also an evolution where we're becoming more and more conscious. As we get bigger, more complex, more conscious, right? Okay, so let's look at the quote for that, page 56. It's so interesting when I'm reading that particular quote, it's so close to the philosopher Gabriel Marcel, whom you have not studied, maybe with me in another class, but he's very similar to what that philosopher is saying. And they're both French, maybe that's why. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth paragraph. It is impossible. Are you there? Okay. It is impossible to deny that deep within ourselves, an interior appears at the heart of beings as if, as it were seen through a rent, right? So he's saying, as we are evolving, something internal is also becoming awakened, right? Notice the similarities or contrasts with Levinas, right? Contrast, Levinas also talks about an awakening, right? At the contact of the other, we become awakened, we become more human. Here he's saying, as we become more complex, we become, something in us awakens, right? So he, this is really a very, very Christian idea. He's talking here about maybe the soul, right? Awakens. As we become more complex, we become more soulful. Interesting repercussions for abortion theory, right? As the baby becomes more complex, there's more of an internal soul taking place, right? All of this is complete theory, of course. This is no scientific basis for any of that, but it's an interesting interpretation. Okay, let's see. Yeah, this is a good enough quote. Oh, sorry, there's another quote, coextensive with their without. Oh, okay, sure. Last sentence of that same paragraph. Oh, you're not there. Okay, sorry. You don't have it. Here it says, coextensive with their without, there is a within. As things evolve on the outside, without, right, without, there is a within evolution, right? Okay. Okay. And then he finishes, right? Beneath this mechanical layer, right, the material layer, we must think of a biological layer that is attenuated to the uttermost, but yet is absolutely necessary to explain the cosmos. the within consciousness is also there, right? So that's just what I've been saying. Okay, so in, throughout the book, you will see he's talking about three stages of evolution. They're very interesting. We begin with the hydrosphere. This is the evolution when water appears on the earth. That wasn't there. So hydrosphere, water in the heavens and water on the earth, right? We know that the heavens also are made of water, right? When you go up, it's water, but like gas, right? So hydrosphere, and then we evolve into the biosphere, which is all the animals, everything that's alive. And then he predicted, it's very interesting, he predicted something that's taking place right now, very recently. He calls it the noosphere, N-O-O-S-P-H-E-R-E. And this is the sphere of knowledge. Basically saying we are getting to a point, first water covered the earth, then life covered the earth, and now knowledge covers the earth. Where do we see this? This knowledge that is covering the earth. How would you, what's the one thing that is doing that right now?
That the internet.
Exactly, right? So he predicted there would be at one point knowledge accessible everywhere in an instant, right? So that's kind of, and this he wrote way before, of course, the internet, right? It's the late, when he writes, 1881 to 1955, right? Early 20th century. Okay, anyways. So, let's go, last quote, 244. This you have? Yes, 244. Okay. Yeah. Ever more complexity and thus ever more consciousness. Where is that? Yeah, there it is. Okay. Go to 1, 2, 3, fourth paragraph. I'm just going to read that long sentence before it. Megasynthesis in the tangential and therefore and thereby a leap forward of the radial energies along the principal axis of evolution, right? He's talking about the complexification, and he says what we're noticing is ever more complexity and thus ever more consciousness, right? So that's kind of how he is observing, right? Looking at the way we evolve and observing, this is interesting as we become more complex, as we have more and more elements aggregated together, we have greater consciousness, right? Okay, so then he's talking now, and we talked about this last time, right? As human beings, we are now the climax, right, of this evolutionary process. There is no more complex being than us. We are the most complex beings on the earth. And so he's asking, is there a next step, right? So what did we say last time? What did I tell you the next step is in our evolution? I think one of you answered that. Yes, by the
way.
Exactly. Now we need to aggregate together us, every human being needs to become a molecule in a bigger organism, which is society, the collective entity. And of course, he predicts if the evolutionary trajectory, if we can take it seriously, as we get more complex, we get more conscious. He's predicting a very high level of consciousness will appear on this earth once we are able to aggregate as individuals, as societies, as nations, as continents. Now we're going to reach unprecedented levels of consciousness. We will achieve an incredible awakening, conscious awakening, right? So that's what he's predicting. And he can do that because if you look at the trajectory of evolution, each time you have more complexity, you have more consciousness. So as we aggregate together and form this bigger complex organism, then yes, it's the trajectory leads us to believe that we will have a powerful awakening of consciousness in the world. As we do that, there will be a powerful awakening, enlightenment will occur on a collective level, right? Okay, so we see this on 107. This is a great quote, actually, so we can write down some of it. Okay, I'll just read the whole paragraph. Are you ready for a little reading? Okay, he says this. We still seem to be able to see all the stages of this still unfinished march of nature towards the unification or synthesis of the ever-increasing products of living reproduction. Right? So he's saying nature is marching, right, towards unification, synthesis, and it's just marching on and on like that. At the bottom, he says, we find the simple aggregate, as in the bacteria and the lower fungi. One stage higher comes the colony of attached cells. Higher still is the metazoan cell of cells, in which there is prodigious critical transformation. Still farther on is at the present limit of our experience and of life's experiments comes society, right? That is the biggest complex organism that is still in the works, right? So because of that mysterious association of three metazoans, right? In which the formation of a hyper-complex units by mega-synthesis seems to be being attempted, right? So he's saying we're moving to more complex, and society is the culmination of that. Okay, so that's the science. That's his interpretation of the science. Now we go into the ramifications. Before that, any questions on anything I said? Because that's the basis. You have to understand. Yeah.
So he's saying the way we're creating these complex societies because we're becoming more like rational and like basically?
Not at all.
So what makes it more complex?
It's different. It's not quite that. It's not because we are enlightened and we are creating society. He's saying as we are creating society through the push of evolution, we are not conscious, right? Evolution didn't happen with us deciding, oh, I will become an amphibian now, right? No, nobody's deciding. There is a force pushing us towards greater complexification, which he calls love, right? Right, when you're a little microorganism, you're not sitting there, let me become a reptile, right? No, something is pushing you. You're not conscious, right? Something is pushing you to become more complex, and it's something outside of you pushing you, right? This is the force that is pushing us towards evolution. So we are now being pushed towards creating societies instinctively, and he's saying we need to follow that push. This is an evolution. But for example, the United Nations, he's saying this didn't come out of the blue, right? Something moved us to that point. We are moving collectively towards the point of the unity of nations. Unconsciously, we're doing that.
What right? About like Hitler? Can you say he was pushing towards a complex society?
No. So, of course. So there's evolution, and then there's always processes which regress, right? So he's saying we are collectively, so even Hitler was trying to go back, right? So there are forces against evolution.
So in Hitler's mind, he saw himself as like making like a pure race, and like he saw yes. that as love for his German people.
So. Yes, very good. So we're going to see how that attitude of Hitler is not part is actually countering the evolutionary process where there's a quote right there that's coming. So he would say these people are anomalies, right? There is a push towards evolution and there is and then we try to refuse it and resist it by becoming individualistic, right? We pull back. And when we pull back in our individualism, we're actually resisting the evolutionary process, right? He's saying. So we have the ability to resist the evolutionary process. We can be like, no. I'm not going to grow a trunk here. Oh, wow. Right. So, but he's saying there is a force pushing us. We can see the world moving towards unification. And we're not consciously doing that, right? But as we're moving towards unification, we are then becoming more rational. You see what I mean? So it's not first I'm rational, then I become a society. It's I'm kind of moved to become a society instinctively, and then I become enlightened, right? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That's how he would say it. So yes, so let's go. Any other questions first on the theory before I go into what he was saying, the isolationist. Okay, so now let's look at the ramifications of the theory. So first of all, what we're learning from this, right, is that progress does not come from an attitude of isolationism. I can't say this. Isolationism. Am I saying, where's the accent? Somebody's American, say it, please. Isolationism. There's an accent and I don't know where it is.
Isolationism.
Okay. Thank you. Isolationism. Okay. So what we're learning, first of all, first consequence of this. Isolationist stance does not equal progress. This is a great question. This would be a great test question, right? America first mentality that we heard a few dark years back, right? This idea of America first, is this going to bring us progress, right? That would be a great question, right? Because he's saying actually, as soon as we begin to isolate and cut off from the rest of the nations, we're actually falling into lower stage of consciousness, right? Lower level of consciousness. So let's see what he says this on page 237, this one you had to read. Okay, so he says this here, he says, habit, dangerous course of seeking fulfillment. Yes. Okay, first line. When man has realized that he, are you there? Yes, who's there? Page 237. Wave amigos there. First line. Okay. When man has realized that he carries the world's fortune in himself and that a limitless future stretches before him in which he cannot founder, his first reflex often leads him along the dangerous course of seeking fulfillment and isolation. And we see this in the acts of certain dictators, right? For example, Hitler. Let us separate the German nation from the rest, right? Let's get rid of the vermin, right? And then we will progress. Or we have this in the isolationist stance that we adopted, for example, during World War II, and that we adopted a few years back also with Trump, right? Just us. Let's not join the other nations. In fact, we will progress more if we're cut off from these guys and not contributing to these guys. We don't need them. We can be stronger alone. He say, right? When you do this, you're going back now to more simple configuration. You're not as complex. And so therefore you're losing consciousness, right? He's saying, basically, if we follow the trajectory of evolution, this is going backwards. So people like Hitler or people like Trump, right? With at least that ideology of America first, so this is going backwards, right? So so he continues, right? He says this, just continue reading. In one example of this, flattering to our private egotism, right, inclines us to think that to give ourselves full scope, we must break away as far as possible from the crowd of others, right? And he says, right, it is not in our aloofness from our fellows or alternatively in their subjection to ourselves that we will find that utmost limit of ourselves, right? So he's saying this is not the key. To be aloof, to break away, or to dominate, right? Domination is also a way to break the complexity, because domination, like colonialism, for example, right? There's just one, everything is made into one molecule. You don't admit that there are other molecules there. You're making them all into you. So oppression, isolation, these are always where we regress. We're going backwards in the trajectory of evolution towards lesser levels of consciousness, right? Okay. So that's the first thing, right? Yes, now he continues and he's going to apply now not only the isolationism, he's going to criticize not only colonialism, he's going to criticize the racist theories of superiority of some races over other races. He says this in 238. So he's going where Senghor is going to go actually. Third paragraph on 238, less theoretical. Are you there? Less theoretical, wait on me if you're there. Yes, one more person. Okay. Less theoretical and less extreme, but all the more insidious, is another doctrine of progress by isolation, which at this very moment is fascinating large sections of mankind. Let me stop there. We have this everywhere right now. We had it in our country, right? America first. We're having it now in countries who are ultra-nationalist countries, right? Who want only one nation. No immigrants, no blacks, no Jews, right? We have this all over Europe right now. We have a rise in Europe of this nationalist, ultra-nationalist movement saying we want only one people here. We don't want any of these foreigners. This he's saying, this you're moving backwards on the trajectory of evolution when you're acting like that. Any form of nationalism, right, which comes along with racist theories of, you know, this is our country, we don't want you here, right? Any mentality like that, he's saying, you're actually regressing right now on the trajectory of evolution, right? You're not understanding that the more complex the society is, the more enlightened it is. In other words, the more differences you have in a given society, the more the society is colorful, right? The more the society has diversity in it, the more progressive the country is, right? And they're wanting to go back to just one nation, right? Just one people, the original people, right? And let's kick out all the others, right? So he's saying, when you're doing this, you're regressing on the trajectory. You're going from higher state of consciousness to lower state of consciousness, right? So he's basically saying, right, this idea of progress by isolation, which is fascinating large sections of mankind, this is a problem, right? Same idea you can see when you conquer, right? When the present conquest, for example, any type of conquest, right? We have a conquest right now of Ukraine, right? This is, okay, we're going to swallow them up, right? They're going to be puppet government, no more their own thing. you're lessening the diversity in the world, you are regressing on the trajectory of evolution, right? Any conquest, any isolation, any nationalism is a regression if you look at things in terms of evolution. So very interesting. So he continues, the doctrine of the selection and election of races, right? Flattering to collective egotism, keener, nobler, more easily aroused than individual egotism, racialism has the virtue in its perspectives of accepting and extending rigorously just as they occur the lines of the tree of life. So he's saying, all this idea that there is a superior nation, no, that nation in isolation is not superior to that nation in cooperation, right? The nation that can cooperate is superior to the nation that stands alone in its so-called superiority, right? So you can see already, hopefully you're already sensing how Senghor is going to grow out of this spontaneously, right? When he's trying to show that we need to recover the lost genius of the African nations so that we can recover that lost treasure of diversity, right? And then we need to engage with these nations and work with them instead of conquering them or ignoring them and so forth, right? So you can already see how Senghor is going to very naturally grow out of this, or really kind of arise out of this context, right? It's really preparing very well what Senghor is going to say. Okay, continuing. Yeah, let's go to 244, just a few more quotes, still on the same idea, just to get more and more ideas and ramifications. Go to 1, 2, 3, fourth paragraph. We just read that one, and we just read ever more complexity and thus ever more consciousness. Are you with me right after that? Fourth paragraph. Megasynthesis, blah, 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 four lines down. If that is what really happens, what more do we need to convince ourselves of the vital error hidden in the depths of any doctrine of isolation? As soon as an individual isolates, as soon as a nation isolates, as soon as a religion or a people or an ethnicity isolates, they're getting weaker, less conscious, right? The egocentric ideal of a future reserved for those who have managed to attain egotistically the extremity of everyone for himself is false and against nature, right? In other words, this idea that we can achieve success on our own without anybody's help is a false idea and it goes against nature, right? We need each other to truly reach progress, right? There's no pulling yourself by your own bootstraps. The more you connect, the more you progress. No element could move and grow except with and by all the others with itself. Very powerful idea here. Let me say it again, please underline it. No element can move and grow except with and by all the others with itself. This is, I was blown away when I read this, to be honest, because we have such an idea that we can become an amazing nation in isolation from the other nations of the world. So the hell with them, right? They can just go and die over there, but we're gonna maintain our greatness in isolation and think that we can become the greatest nation on the earth in isolation. I mean, we really think that, right? And he's saying here, actually, no. You're never gonna reach your full potential as a nation unless you are with and by the others, right? So the ability to create alliances with the world and connect with the world and support the world as the world is supporting us is how we will get somewhere really genuinely great, right? Again, this brings me back to the way that the vaccine distribution was handled, right? So the idea, oh, let's save ourselves, right? The hell with those nations who, you know, don't have the money to afford the vaccine, thinking we can save ourselves in isolation. Again, false and against nature, says Teilhard de Chardin, right? You cannot save yourself. You can only save yourself together, right? We cannot, as a society, really reach the highest levels alone. Not possible. Against nature. Here's another couple quotes. Continuing. Also false and against nature is the racial ideal of one branch. That's just what I said now. One branch draining up for itself alone all the sap of the tree and rising over the death of other branches. This is the history of colonization. If you want to read a great, really depressing, passionately depressing book, Eduardo Galeano, The Open Veins of Latin America. Amazing book. And then he wrote some trilogy in the same line of thought, talking about how the colonizers drained the country of its resources and of its human resources and material resources. And he's talking about Spain, the European countries, right? And then thought that they could progress like that, right? So this has been the history of humankind for ages. We drained this country to become strong. He's saying, you can't do that. You would become even stronger if they were strong alongside you, right? This is what we forget. We're like, let me take to become strong. But he's saying is actually, no. If they're strong, you're even stronger, right? You can't be strong by pressing down others. That's not true strength. You can be a little bit strong, but true strength, true enlightenment will be when they are strong and you are strong, and now you're working together to build something higher. Now you're reaching the highest level of your civilization. True civilization doesn't come by pushing down others and, you know, draining them of their resources so you can be bloated and grow by yourself, right? True civilization and growth and enlightenment comes when both are strong, right? That's what he's saying here. To reach the sun, nothing less is required than the combined growth of the entire foliage. This is a very beautiful image, right? The tree, to really reach to access the full energetic potential of the sun. It's not enough one leaf and then killing all the other leaves so it can get the sun by itself, right? No, it's when all the leaves are functioning that the tree really gets the sun, right? So imagine a leaf sitting there saying, I want the sun to myself. Let me destroy all those leaves. What's gonna happen to that leaf? Can you tell me, those who study biology? If you destroy all the leaves of a tree and there's only one leaf getting the sun, how is this leaf going? How long is this leaf going to survive?
Not very long.
The tree will die, right? If the tree doesn't have all the right, if you don't have all of the leaves, you don't get enough energy for the tree itself to survive. So if you have just one leaf saying, I want the sun to myself and I want to survive by myself on this tree, actually no, because the tree itself will die from lack of sun because there's not enough leaves grabbing. So that's what he's saying is happening to us. We have nations sitting there killing off all the other leaves, trying to access all the natural resources, but actually killing themselves in the process, right? Just like that tree would die if you cut off all the leaves and stick just one there, even that leaf will die, right? It's a very nice image here. The outcome of the world, the gates of the future, the entry into the superhuman. I would love a science fiction movie like based on Teilhard and Chardin. It would be so cool. These are not thrown open to just a few of the privileged, nor to one chosen people, to the exclusion of all others. These gates of the future will open only to an advance of all together in a direction in which all together can join and find completion in a spiritual renovation of the earth, a renovation whose physical degree of reality we must now consider, etc. Okay, so that's the idea again, right? Only together will we reach true progress, not in isolation. Okay, let's see, is there any more quotes? I have 246. Oh, this is a nice one. Okay, second paragraph in the middle. No evolutionary future. Are you there? Okay. No evolutionary future awaits man except in association with all other men. That's another great quote. I wish he was studied more. Like, he's so interesting. Okay. So that's the idea, right? This is, I think I have all the quotes I need. Yes, and then there's one more idea here. Okay, so that's the main thing, right? That the ramification he's getting from this kind of observation of the way of the evolutionary trajectory, he's saying, well, you know, the culmination is the complex organism of society, and we need to understand that to really reach progress, we cannot do so in isolation. It is only together, as we unite as individuals, as we unite societies, as we unite nations, that we will reach this higher state of consciousness. Now, here's the interesting last thought, which I find interesting. What he noticed also, looking at evolution, is that the more complex the organism, the more differentiated are the parts of that organism. So now he's going to talk about the nature of this new world order that he's talking about, the nature of this big organism, right? He's going to tell us something in the sense that this new organism has to remain complex. It cannot be an organism where everyone speaks the same language, everyone is doing the same thing, there's one leadership, one, you know, one English language, one way of doing things, the Western way, and so forth. This is not what this great big organism looks like. He says the more complex we are, the more differentiated are the parts. Here's how you spell differentiated. It's important word, D-I-F-F-E-R-E-N-T, different. And then I-A-T-E-D, differentiated. Okay, so let me explain what he means by that. As we get more complex, so let's take the book here and me. Book is pretty simple. You have a few pages, you have a cover, a title, three different colors. Pretty differentiated, but me, when you look at me, well, if I'm sorry, I don't dress in many colors, so the book beat me to it. But yeah, I have a lot more different things going on than the book, right? The more complex, the more different parts you have. So it's not a homogeneous organism. It's a heterogeneous organism, right? And he's saying we notice in evolution, as it gets more complex and more conscious, it gets more differentiated. That means more diverse, right? So he's saying when we start to agglomerate different people together, different societies together, we need to make sure we preserve the diversity of the different parts of the agglomeration, right? So in other words, not like what we're doing today, or not like colonization was doing. Colonization goes in the country and says, you're all French now, you're all British now, right? You're gonna speak French, you're gonna speak English, you're gonna go to French schools, English schools, Spanish schools, right? You're gonna learn that language, screw your language. Your language is from the devil, your traditions are from the devil, forget them, become like us. This is literally what happened for several hundred years. Teilhard Chardin is saying, this is not going in the direction of evolution. This is regressing back to more simple organisms, right? We need to, when we unite with each other, it cannot be in the sense that we have to be like each other. We have to maintain the difference. We have to maintain the complexity if we want to become a wicked. So he's warning us, right? As we become more agglomerated, let us not fall into the trap of becoming homogeneous societies or McDonald's societies, we say in France, right? We make fun of the globalization there. Imperialism, cultural imperialism of the United States, which has put its McDonald's everywhere. And so we in France, we call this McDonald's society, where everyone is the same and so forth. We need to escape that, because that is a going down from the trajectory. Back to simple organism. We need to make sure as we agglomerate that the diversity is protected, celebrated, cherished, guarded from the homogeneity. And that's how we become more enlightened, right? So that's what he says here, last quote, 262. I hope I have enough battery to say this quote. My computer is dying. Okay. okay. Sure. Third paragraph. In any domain, are you there? Yes. In any domain, whether it be the cells of a body, the members of a society, the elements of a spiritual synthesis, union differentiates, right? Anytime you get more complex, it becomes more differentiated. In every organized whole, the parts perfect themselves and fulfill themselves, right? We become more ourselves as we join with others. It's very interesting. As we unite and cooperate with others, we actually become more like ourselves. Senghor is going to have a field day with this, right? And we saw this already with Buber. I say you, how was it that quote? I become I by being, what was it? Somebody help me. What was that amazing quote by Buber where he says, becoming I say you. Remember that? Anyway, somewhere in, I end up, yes. I forgot, of course. I can barely remember the quote. Oh, this, sorry. This is page 262. Right, remember when Buber says, becoming you, I say I, or becoming I, sorry, becoming I say you. So in, he's saying the same thing. I become truly myself and living us when he says, when we respond to the other, we reach our highest level of self, right? Same idea. When we conglomerate, when we unite with, when we start to cooperate with others, we become fully ourselves, individually. Our unique gift emerges at that moment when we start to work as a collectivity, right? So he says that. Okay, let me stop the recording there before it dies.